Hello and welcome to week two of editing. And this week we're going to move from continuity editing into non-continuity or non-linear editing. So if you haven't already, I'm going to suggest you take a look at the two videos that I left on the announcements page, one about continuity editing and the other about a moment from Citizen Kane that I kind of break apart in terms of looking at rhythm. With the first video I mentioned, though, what I do is to look at a scene from somebody you've been hearing an awful lot about, D.W. Griffith, and looking at how it's put together. This is from 1915, and you will see by looking at a clip from Blade Runner 2049, which came out in 2017. I know all these years are getting confusing, but the same techniques are being used basically more than 100 years later. And so it also, I think, kind of demonstrates what I'll be looking for in your next significant paper. That is a shot-by-shot breakdown of a scene or a sequence. And I think you'll find that done most clearly in the video on continuity editing. So I've, for this unit, taken a film, which is really quite good and worth seeing in its entirety, called The Cutting Edge. And I'm going to be inserting my own videos into an edited version of The Cutting Edge so that we can see how discontinuity evolved and how it works. And so I'm going to disappear, and you're going to look at this film with questions, and on we go.
Cut!
A major Hollywood production shoots almost 200 hours of film. Unspooled, the film would stretch from LA to Vegas. An editor may work for months, even years, crafting this footage into a two-hour movie. The finished film will contain thousands of shots, each measured in frames of 1/24th of a second.
For a writer, it's a word, all right? For a composer or a musician, it's a note. All right, for an editor and a filmmaker, it's the frames, all right? And you know, the one frame off or two frames added or two frames less is the difference between a sour note and a sweet note. It's the difference between a clunky, clumsy crap, all right, and orgasmic rhythm.
Vernon Fields made many good contributions to Jaws. We all refer to Verna Fields as Mother Cutter because she was very earthy and very maternal. She cut her films at her house, in her pool house, in the San Fernando Valley, and it was a very Hamish kind of a workplace. The shark didn't work as well or as often as it was supposed to work, according to the screenplay.
That's the spot.
We had a contest where Verna would stop the Moviola on a frame where she wanted to make the cut, and I would stop it where I wanted to make the cut. And if ever we stopped it on the same frame that had already been marked with a grease pencil X, we knew that was the right frame on certain things where we didn't agree. And we, all of our disagreements always happen with that darn shark. Verna was always in favor of making less to be more. And I was trying to squeeze that one more because it took me days to get the one shot. So I'm going back to, I'm on a barge for 2 days trying to get the shark to look real. And the sad fact was the shark would only look real in 36 frames, not 38 frames. And that two-frame difference was the difference between something really scary and something that looked like a great white floating turd.
Out of my way.
Well, I got so desperate on Terminator 2, trying to shorten that film to a, you know, manageable length, as we all understand that to be, that I said, well, wait a minute, do we really need all these frames? If we just took out one frame every second for the entire film, we'd shorten the film by a couple of minutes. Let's just do it as a test. We'll take a reel and we'll take out one frame in every 24. And the editors looked at me like I was nuts. Let's just try it. Come on, nobody's ever done this. We took out one frame in every 24, and it was a mess. There were jerks, there were things, there were cuts in the wrong places. You totally saw it, and it just didn't work. Every one of those individual frames was important. Once you know that as an editor, now you get scared for a while. It's like, geez, you know, am I cutting here or am I cutting here? But then after a while, you start to realize that there's great power in that.
I'd like to go back here to the Terminator 2 and Cameron's drive to make his film shorter by cutting out one frame a second, which is, of course, the least you could cut out in a film when using film stock. And basically, as he said, you get these jumping motions, like there, there, there. It's almost like a metronome. The second, second, second. And we have these jumps, which are probably more noticeable, like here, cut, cut, cut. So what we have there is the example of what is really a jump cut. And what a jump cut does is to take a bit of footage and remove frames from a shot. So this is a single shot. We're going to get another shot in a moment where it will become more noticeable, this shot. And so you see the jumps, and you're not changing location, you're not changing the camera setup, you're simply taking out frames within a shot. That is a jump cut. It's not jumping to another location or quick cutting to a close-up. It's taking frames, usually more than one, out of a shot. And we notice this, as Cameron said. We are going to jump back to the 30s, 40s, and 50s very quickly and look at what became known as the rules, how to put a scene together. And we've talked about this, but I want to reestablish this so that we can move on quickly to talk about how these rules were broken by intentionally using things like the jump cut and other techniques involving editing to disorient the viewer or to kind of suggest a state of mind. So let's take a look at those
editors worked on Cutter's Row and were expected to conform to the established rules of editing.
If we were to think about the films that were being made, there was a certain film language that was very, very distinct. Certain kinds of coverage, long shot, two shot, single, single. There was almost a formulaic way of presenting films. This film language was very strict. And in editorial terms, there were rules that one felt could not be broken.
A master shot had to come first. And then if you had an overshoulder, you went to the overshoulder. And you never went to the close-up till you'd done the whole dance coming from far to close.
For instance, if you were going to have a transition from one place to the next, it would be done with a dissolve.
You've got to remember is that a gentleman you meet among the cold cuts is simply not as attractive as one that you meet, say, in the mink department at Bergdorf's.
In the 40s and 50s, the audience would expect a character to drive up, show him getting out of the car, he would walk up to the building, and then he would open the door, and then the editor would match cut the door opening on the other side, and he would walk in and come over and sit down.
Pull up a chair.
It just seemed to me absolutely stupid that you had to show somebody coming down the stairs and all the way across the road and up the other side. I mean, you knew that they were coming from here and they were going to there. Why couldn't you just cut directly?
Oh là là, Michel.
Je peux entrer?
Oui.
In France, a group of film critics turned directors also challenged the doctrine of invisible editing and launched a revolution among editors.
When I first saw the French Nouvelle Vague, I instantly loved it. I loved the idea. I loved the way they edited and thought I would like to cut like that.
J'aime une fille qui a une très jolie nuque, de très jolis seins,
Une très jolie voix, de très jolies poignets, un très joli front, de très jolis genoux.
You know, Godard used jump cuts because it was like, well, why not? You know, there's nothing interesting happening in this middle part, so let's just go to a jump cut.
When I saw Breathless, I was staggered at Godard's brutality.
What they brought to editing was a breaking of the rules. Whatever books that said this is how it had to be done, they burned them.
Breathless is too hip for me. I come from Lower East Side. I'm an Italian-American guy. It's too beatnik. It's like, you know, bohemian. It's too cool. I liked it. I don't know what the hell was happening in it.
You know, when I first saw Breathless in the 60s, it's like, wow. I mean, just in the first 5 minute sequence in introducing Jean-Paul Belmondo's character as this petty thief, I mean, every rule was violated in terms of how long to hold a shot, the discontinuity of what was going on, even screen directions, you know, were mixed in. And I thought, like, either this guy doesn't know what he's doing, or he's so confident that he has the grammar of film down that he's trying to show us a new way to use the material he has to tell the story.
There were some films that really changed our perception of what filmmaking was, and certainly it affected what editing was. I mean, I think one of those seminal films is certainly something like Bonnie and Clyde.
Some people say I broke those rules first. I certainly did not. I mean, the Russians broke those rules, and the Germans broke those rules. This was nothing new, but it was new for Hollywood.
Several editors have had big impacts on me, have influenced my thinking. Dee Dee Allen certainly is one who has taught me that. Don't be afraid to take a chance on doing something that doesn't seem like it's going to work. When Beatty and Faye Dunaway get to know each other, they're standing on the street corner, and she says, "I don't believe you robbed banks." And he said, "Yes, I do. Look at my gun." And he pulls it out and holds it to her on the street corner. And that could easily have been done with the tilt down to the gun, the pan over to her hands fidgeting with a Coke bottle, up to her face. But it was done in her eyes look from him down, gun, back to him. It keeps you on edge. There's the excitement, there's the danger, there's the eroticism in not being able to fully get every moment because you're cutting it off and you are not allowing the moment to come to fruition.
Bonnie and Clyde was much more violent than anything we'd done because basically the Americans like violence much more than we do.
Well, it was shot in so many wonderful ways because this is the scene that Arthur intended to be cut in this fashion. The fact that it was so beautifully executed right from the very first cut. Jerry Greenberg was my assistant, and on the last scene, I left Jerry alone with that scene, and he did all the primary editing on that. All I did was tighten it later.
Again, one is not saying that this was the beginning of the American New Wave, because one is sure that there were smaller films before that. But this was the one that, like Birth of a Nation, which suddenly an audience noticed and said, wow.
Bonnie and Clyde paved the way for films like Easy Rider.
So I had only had one feature under my belt. We started on Easy Rider. I was editing while they were traveling. Footage was flowing in by the mile. It was great, it was exciting, it was totally different than anything I had been involved in.
You asshole!
These transitions that everybody remembers going from one scene to the next, where it flashes forward to the scene, flashes back to the scene you're in. Dennis didn't want a straight cut. I didn't want dissolves. So we kept throwing it around, and it was Dennis who cooked the part of the idea, which was, what if we went and then came back? And I said, yeah, but let's do it three times. Then we finally arrived at the length, and each one is six frames. Said, now we can use this whenever we want to. Well, as it turned out, it started to become a device. And we stopped doing that. I said, no, we aren't going to do that. We're only use it in special places. Without giving anything away, everybody was stoned when they were shooting. I learned soon on that I could not be stoned and edit. While it was going on, I thought it was grand. Then I look at it when I was straight, and I say, this is awful. I got to throw it out and start all over. This film has become an icon. I'm grateful that I had something to do with it, because I had grown up in the in the 30s, 40s, and 50s with movies as they were then.
I think it's safe to say that if the 30s through the 50s in Hollywood was about making rules, the 60s and 70s in Hollywood were about breaking them. And if earlier Hollywood cinema was about hiding cuts, the cinema of the 60s and 70s was about kind of languishing in the cut and experimenting with various types of editing techniques that really, most of which were not especially new, which you'll know if you've read the textbook about the Soviets, but which were being employed in kind of interesting and different ways. So I want to take a look at a moment from a film called SLC Punk, which is actually from 1998. And I want you to pay attention to, and I'll start you off with this, how we use classical transitions in interesting ways, but also how the rhythm of the film
ignoring the truth kind of creative. So what I do, I drop Dasu with Sandy in Highland Park is to further ignore the truth.
This shit is good. I got it from Trish. Trish got it from Mark.
It's a weird couple, Bob and Trish.
Do you think they're in love?
Don't know. I'll have to ask them that. It's weird.
Okay, jumping back, did you notice anything odd there? Well, what we have at the very beginning is a series of dissolves that don't really take us any closer to the action. A dissolve, you might remember, is usually used to take us to another time and place. But here, we stay within the park, and the foregrounding of the dissolve becomes evident because normally, as you know, when we cut on dialogue, it's usually a straight cut. And we're about to establish a pace that is going to become more and more rapid in the jump cut, same camera setup, a jump cut. And the jump cuts are going to become more predominant as well with the dissolve coming. And again, notice how the editing is getting quicker. So I'm going to leave this, the rest of this to you, and I'm going to ask you a question about it after you have seen this, but onward we go. To conclude, I'd like to take a look at the rest of the cutting edge. And so we'll get into a couple of things relative to editing in the 21st century, including 3D editing and the rapidity of editing, how fast it's become. So the second video that I've produced is about other forms of nonlinear editing, like cross-cutting, split-screen editing, subliminal editing, and so on. So I'm hoping that this unit is self-sufficient.
Another change in editing is the accelerated pace of movies, a subject of controversy among filmmakers.
An encounter with two swords 30 years ago would have been probably done in a master shot and a couple of extensions. Today, that encounter could evolve into 200 shots. Split second, eye blink, a blade going into a chest, slight movement of the wrist. So the audience is taken right down into this roller coaster ride of minutiae, and that's what they want.
Because kids today are raised on television and in MTV and commercials, they not only can process information faster and understand what images mean, but that they demand it.
I think the MTV generation in the 80s kind of created this style of editing. And Billy Weber and I on Top Gun, we were pushed in that direction. Jerry Bruckheimer and Don Simmet were very much in tune with their audiences. They felt that that was what the audiences liked, and I think they were proven right, given the box office on some of those early movies.
And I mean, fast cutting was not invented now or with MTV. Just look at Lou Lombardo's work on The Wild Bunch.
Sometimes a cutting style is effective inside of a movie to shake you up and rattle your soul, but consistently to have that style pounding away at you like a metronome on high speed for 2.5 hours is a little bit, at least for me, maybe I'm just getting old, but it's a little bit debilitating. Now, it doesn't bother my kids, because my kids were raised on 30-second commercials and on MTV and VH1, and they were raised on video games.
I feel like I was born 80 and I'm growing backwards. So now I'm somewhere around 27. You know, I get a tattoo and I'm feeling closer to a generation that has learned to absorb information at a speed that was heretofore unthinkable. And where their rhythms are well more hungry than a traditional narrative pace.
What I'm afraid of is the tendency for everything to go by quickly. And I'm afraid of what it does to the culture. A sense of consuming something and throwing it away, as opposed to being enveloped with something. Taking the time to see and experience time in a different way.
The digital revolution has further enhanced the poetic powers of the editor. George Lucas, who began his career as an editor, is one of the pioneers of this new technology.
All art is technology. That's the very nature of it. The artist is always bumping against that technology. And the advent of, whether it's a new color of blue, whether it's a proscenium arch, whatever it is, it changes the way we work in that art form.
With computer technology, editors now can make changes within the frame, adding or removing elements from the original image. This increases the editor's control, but also multiplies the number of decisions to be made.
Now you can edit what I call in 3D, which is you have a scene and you have people in the scene, and you can cut those people out, you can move them around in the scene, you can go in for a close-up, you can go out, you can sort of direct the film in the editing room, which is, growing up as an editor, what I've always wanted to do.
The new technology also makes it possible to cut the movie before shooting begins. Pre-visualization gives an editor much more input in planning the movie.
And I have a system now because of the digital world. I have a group of kids really do little videomatics of things, and we have a little blue screen. We can send these editors in and shoot scenes on just an amateur video camera. And so I can actually shoot the film and make the film and write the film right there in the editing room. And every main character in our movie has a digital counterpart. We have totally virtual actors now, and we use them quite a bit. Mostly we use them for stunts and things. And we have a lot of situations where it's better to use a digital actor than it is to use a real actor. Christopher Lee is 80 years old. He can't really fight the way he did in Attack of the Clones. You're not going to get an artificial intelligence computer that's neurotic enough to be able to understand how you create a performance. Performance is an art.
At the end of the day, all this stuff has to work to tell a story. And if you're not telling a story, it doesn't matter.